Louis Rukeyser. Brought to you by public television stations. By CSX, the company that puts things in motion. By Prudential Beach Securities, the investment firm with rock-solid resources and market-wise thinking in the business of making money. And by Primerica, the new name in financial services and specialty retailing, a company with the resources to fund growth for tomorrow. Primerica, a name to remember. Produced Friday, February 26. Our panelists are William Gross, Carter Randall, and Robert Stovall. Tonight's special guest is Alan H. Meltzer, professor of economics, Carnegie Mellon University.
Good evening, I'm Louis Rukeyser. This is Wall Street Week. Welcome back. Well, this was the week when the best example for market forecasters was set by the Reverend Jimmy Swaggart. Confess that you've sinned, don't be too specific about the numbers, and step down for 3 months. Come to think of it, it wouldn't be bad advice for the presidential candidates either. This week's sinners also included the economic prognosticators who keep predicting doom while the actual numbers keep getting favorably revised, including new reports that growth has been stronger and inflation less virulent than previously estimated. This news proves something of a disappointment to the ghouls who see recession around every bend, especially after Federal Reserve Chairman Alan Greenspan, scarcely a Pollyanna by anybody's count, told Congress he expects the economy to chug slowly ahead this year without his unleashing a torrent of greenbacks. Confession might be good for some of the gold bugs, too. As evidence mounted that consumer prices are continuing to behave, the precious metals fell to 10-month lows, with gold below $430 an ounce, or less than half its 1980 high, and oil dipping below $16 a barrel, to the consternation of the sinners in OPEC. Other unmasked sinners included, would you believe it, the Internal Revenue Service. The General Accounting Office reported that the IRS's toll-free telephone service gives the wrong answer to about 2 callers out of 5. Put that in your 1040 and smoke it. And if that's not enough sin for 1 week, consider that Playboy magazine arrived on Wall Street to start screening candidates for an upcoming Women of Wall Street pictorial that it said would feature nude female investment bankers, stockbrokers, and corporate finance executives, thereby giving new meaning to the term bear market. We tonight will seek redemption in the company of one of the nation's most distinguished monetary economists, who says that when we look at the federal budget problems, we haven't even identified the right sinners. Get your cameras ready, folks. But first, let's check out the financial evangelists in Wall Street. The Dow Jones Industrial Average moved by early Thursday to levels it hasn't seen since before the October crash, but it couldn't quite hold them. Still, it managed, barely, to keep a 3-week winning streak intact, rising another 8.5 points to 2023.21, which did put it at its best weekly close since the panic. The broader indexes did better, all of them reaching this week the highest closing levels since October 16th. Our elves, though, are pulling in their tassels a bit. At a neutral plus one, their technical market index is now giving its lowest reading since the collapse. And I'm sure there will be panic in the streets over that one. Even with indications that the Fed was determined not to unleash the floodgates of money and thereby force down interest rates for a while, the dollar ended the week lower against all major foreign currencies. The most conspicuous feature of the stock market this week was the Dow's downhill flight after failing to post a new closing high. Does that have any long-term market significance, Carter Randall?
No, I don't think so, Lou, but I have to admit that people were looking back at October 18th, and they saw what the market did, and now we got back to where
we were.
The 18th
was a Sunday.
I know. The day before the crash is what I'm talking about. The 19th was the crash, but I'm talking about the 18th.
Okay.
And they saw what the market did the day before the crash, and here the market goes back to almost that level, and they think maybe it's time to get out. I disagree. I think the market's still undervalued. 6 months ago, it was obviously overvalued. It was time to sell. Now it's undervalued. It's time to buy. And the thinking of people is just the opposite. People are scared now. They should have been scared then.
Carney, you were pretty good on fair value last year. What's fair value now?
$22.50. I come to that very glibly, but I have a reason for it. It correlates with the yield on a 20-year Treasury bond. And I say that stocks ought to sell at a 20% premium to the capitalization rate of the 20-year Treasury bonds. So $22.50 is fair value.
Does the market usually go to fair value?
It always goes to fair value, at least historically. The problem is it always goes through fair value, and that's when you have to take a contrarian view. We haven't gone through it yet. We did on the downside. Now we got to do it on the upside again.
Bob Stovall, with all the highly paid money managers in Wall Street, isn't it kind of silly they just mechanically sell when you get to a previous high?
I hope you're not thinking about anybody specifically with that, Lou. But
No, I'm not talking about noble philosophers like yourself. I mean all those other guys.
Well, I think this whole idea of programmed buying, programmed selling, the old portfolio balance rules that we used to follow 20 years ago, they haven't proved over a long period of time that they really amount to much. But while watching with some fascination the Dow's inability to close above 2051, I've noticed that we have sort of a reverse two-tier market underway. By that I mean the small stocks, which had done nothing from the middle of 1983 until recently, the small stocks are doing quite well. The NASDAQ had an 11-day winning streak just broken here on Friday. So people are buying small stocks rather than big stocks and buying them consistently. I think they're trying to avoid getting mixed up with stocks that get hammered by the portfolio traders in the afternoons.
Is that a strategy you would recommend at this point?
I think it's a good idea for individuals, because if you want to stay away from program traders and portfolio insurers and index income enhancers, then deal in stocks that don't have options and stocks that these big fellows don't move in. So you'll find some good values. Actually, I saw a chart the other day where the valuation on these stocks is the lowest it's been versus the S&P 500 since 1974, that bear market then.
Obviously, a number of people agree with you. The OTC index has been up for 5 weeks straight.
Yes, yes.
Bill Gross, what do you make of the course of interest rates, which I know you watch closely? What do you think Alan Greenspan has or has not done to them this week?
Well, he's helped them out a little bit, Lou. I think the market, the bond market, is in a trading range at the moment. We've come a long way, probably 50 basis points or 0.5% since the beginning of the year. And for the bond market, that's a long distance to travel. And so we've got to consolidate at this point. I think any further progress depends upon slow economic growth and or a recession. And whether or not we get that in the next 3 to 6 months or perhaps in February or March of 89, I think we're going to see lower interest rates one way or the other. Remember that a new administration, whether it's Republican or Democrat, typically likes to take that recession, if they can manipulate it, right in the early stages of its administration. And I think within the next 12 months, we're looking to slow growth and lower interest rates.
Do you think the president really can schedule recessions with that much precision?
Not really, but
I think of Jimmy Carter, who had his in 1980, which wasn't perfectly timed.
But, you know, Reagan did it. Nixon did it. It's been done through time, and perhaps if Carter didn't, that's the reason why he wasn't reelected.
Well, I'm sure he'll be pleased to have your analysis. In any event, gentlemen, it's time now to play Dear Abby with a cash register. Carter Randall, John St. Clair of Johnson City, Tennessee, wonders why anyone should be concerned about the falling value of the dollar in relation to other currencies. A falling dollar, he observes, makes American goods cheaper for foreigners, makes foreign goods less attractive to Americans, thereby helping our balance of trade. What's the problem, he wants to know?
Well, he's right. You know, most economic news is both good news and bad news. The falling dollar helps our ability to export, and it helps us to meet foreign competition. However, there's another side to that. It makes what we import more expensive, oil, for instance, and it also makes us have to keep interest rates high in order to attract capital into this country to finance a big deficit. the ideal would be a stable dollar, neither a strong nor a weak dollar, a stable dollar. That would be the ideal.
You think we're going to get it?
Oh, eventually, but then we'll go through it one way or another again.
Bob Stovall, how would you respond to Douglas Stuber of Columbus, Ohio, who writes as follows? I know what it means when trading has been halted in a certain stock. It means you can't buy it or sell it. But I'm unclear about some details. Why is trading halted? Who decided to stop the trading? Who decided then to start it trading again? I certainly wouldn't mind if my stock is dropping, but I might not be too happy if it is rising.
Well, trading is halted when something different has happened. And there are essentially three ways that you halt and then reopen again. Number one is when there's an imbalance of orders. If there are too many orders to buy versus those to sell, then the specialist in the stock reopens it after a passage of time after he consults with a floor governor. Otherwise, it's either dissemination of news, a halt for that, or waiting for some major corporate announcement, such as a merger or a new find of a new ore body, let's say. In those cases, that's decided upstairs by the New York Stock Exchange people. And we hope that when the stock market is moving up, that the halts don't take too long.
Typically, how long do they last?
It can last, as typically, I'd say, less than 10 minutes.
Bill Gross, Alvin Ivers of Philadelphia, thinks the fast food business may now be ready for a comeback. Do you agree with him? And if so, can you recommend to him any fast food companies with good growth records and low price earnings multiples?
Well, whenever you talk about fast food, Lou, you look to the prices of meat, namely poultry and beef, as well as the price of wages. Meats have behaved themselves in terms of commodity prices, but there are storm warnings for minimum wage prices. In other words, the minimum wage may be rising here over the next 6 to 12 months, and that may raise the cost of labor for fast food enterprises about 25% or 10% overall in terms of the total cost of goods. In a 3% inflationary world, that's a stiff price increase to pass along to customers. So I'd go slow with fast food at the moment. If I were to select a stock or to pluck a stock, so to speak, off the New York Stock Exchange, I'd take Collins Foods. That's a Kentucky Fried distributor. It has a P/E of about 11 times and yields a paltry, or should I say a poultry, 1.5%.
Okay, no guarantees, and if Mr. Gross is wrong, you'll have no beef coming. All right, now if the stock market has been eating you alive and you'd like to digest some fast profits for a change with lots of lettuce, why not seek some tasty McNuggets from our panelists? They might help you cut the mustard if you give us your order here at Wall Street Week, Owings Mills, Maryland, 21117. That's Wall Street Week, Owings Mills, Maryland, 21117. Now, before we meet tonight's special guest, let's take one of our periodic looks at what's really been happening to government spending and taxes in America, as we consider a question that has been the subject of more heat than light on both sides of the political aisle. How much has Reagan cut? With the help of figures compiled for us by the Nonpartisan Tax Foundation, let's look first at federal spending over the past generation. Such spending took 18.2% of the nation's output in 1960, and even less, 17.8%, in 1965, as the big Vietnam buildup was beginning. But Washington's share passed even those wartime levels as the 1970s progressed, reaching 23% of our gross national product in 1981, when Ronald Reagan replaced Jimmy Carter. Since then, surprise, federal spending has gone up to new highs, peaking at 24.7% of GNP in 1982, but resting even last year at 23.8% of an economy in its fifth straight year of expansion. And when you add in state and local spending, you find that in five of the past 6 years, including 1987, total government spending has been within one-tenth of a point of 35% of the economy. Well, then, is the problem simply, as many say, that we have cut taxes too much? Not so you'd notice. Federal taxes took just over 18.5% of GNP in 1960, when the budget, believe it or not, showed a surplus, and peaked, beating even the World War II figures, at 20.6% in 1981. After a brief descent following the first Reagan tax bill, the federal tax share is again creeping up toward the all-time high, having reached 20.1% in 1987. In fact, if you add in rising state and local taxes, you find that, despite all the partisan rhetoric on both sides, total U.S. taxes last year marched to an unprecedented level, 30.4% of our nation's output. And even that record doesn't include a bunch of so-called user fees and non-tax receipts. As President Reagan would be the first to tell you, there are a number of other fellows who have had a lot to say about the level of government spending and taxing during his presidency. But since government taxes are, in reality, as we've just seen, taking their highest ever share of the U.S. economy, could it be that the actual deficit problem lies elsewhere, say, on the spending side? For some thoughts on that, let's go over now and meet tonight's special guest, Alan H. Meltzer. Alan, welcome back.
Thank you, Lou.
Very pleased to have you here again. When you become chairman of the Federal Reserve Board, you get Alan Meltzer in the bargain, whether you want him or not, for he is co-chairman of the so-called Shadow Open Market Committee, which has turned unofficial Fed watching into a national sport. When he's not instructing Paul Volcker or Alan Greenspan as to what they should have done, Dr. Meltzer is a professor of economics at Carnegie Mellon University. He is tonight making his second appearance as my guest. Alan, you have suggested that Americans may be worrying too much about the budget deficit. Could you explain?
Well, there's too much emphasis on the budget deficit and not enough on the share of that's going to taxes and spending that you just put on the screen. The problem is that spending has been rising too rapidly, and what we need to do, we could control the budget deficit problem very well if we would just get the growth of spending a little bit below the growth of output, and I think over 4 or 5 years in the next presidential term, that's an entirely doable thing if we condition and hold back our spending growth.
Do you see this Congress capable of making that kind of restraint?
I think there would be a better chance of it if one of the presidential candidates would run on a program, enunciate that as a program, and try to implement it. And we're beginning to move somewhat in that direction with candidates taking the tax pledge, which I think is a good thing, and then and beginning to make some comments about phasing down the budget.
Well, you're no longer a nonpartisan. It was revealed this week that you're an advisor to Bob Dole. Does he accept this? Would he take the pledge? He's been known to raise a tax or two in his time.
Right. He has taken the pledge on income taxes, and of course, but he's not yet taken my pledge to cut the growth of spending. He has promised to freeze spending in the first year in office, but he hasn't taken the pledge that I would like to take, which is to cut the growth of spending below the growth of government over a 3 to 4 year period.
Have you advised him to do it?
Yes, I have.
You think he might?
I can't answer that.
Alan, you're a monetarist economist, which means you pay close attention to the growth of the money supply in America. This week, the Fed indicated it was no longer going to pay so much attention to money supply. Could you comment on the change as you see it and the advisability for the country?
I think that paying attention to the money stock on a week-to-week basis is a very poor idea, and I believe that the Fed will be making an even bigger mistake if they pay no attention to it at all over a longer-term basis. And the important thing about controlling money growth is not to try to do it week-to-week or month-to-month. It's to try to do it over from year to year, and I believe if they don't do that, they'll be making a serious error.
Although you look too young for this to be true, you've been at Carnegie Mellon over 30 years. You've given a lot of grades. What grade would you give Paul Volcker for the job he did at the Fed? What grade would you now give Alan Greenspan?
Well, I think Volcker did a fine job of bringing the inflation rate down. He did it in a very costly and perhaps too precipitate way. I think he mishandled the international debt problem and some of those things. So I gave him, I think the last time I was here, I gave him a grade of about a C or a C minus, and I think that that's probably correct. Alan Greenspan hasn't been there long enough. I mean, he's only taken the midterm. We want to wait until he completes a few more courses.
He was widely praised for supplying money, liquidity in the jargon, to the markets after the crash. Do you praise him for that?
I did, indeed, at the time, absolutely.
Others have criticized him for pulling back too quickly. Are you among them?
Yes, I think that they pulled back too quickly. I think the markets would have been better off if there had been a little bit less rise in interest rates toward the end of the year.
Is the present level of monetary growth too high, too low, or about right?
I think that now that money growth has picked up a little bit, the numbers that I look at say that I think we're in a comfortable position, steering a course between trying to keep the economy moving along and forward without getting inflation back up again.
What is your forecast this year for economic growth and for inflation?
I think that the standard forecast, the modestly optimistic side of the standard forecast looks good to me. I'm not too far away from the Council of Economic Advisors, 2 to 2.5%, and I think that inflation has settled into the 4 to 6% range.
We're talking the Consumer Price Index?
Well, any one of them really will be in that range.
And how about unemployment?
Unemployment is probably going to come down some still this year.
Let's turn you over to my Council of Economic Advisors, starting with Carter Randall.
Thank you, Lou. Let me switch you to taxes. We had a major piece of legislation in 1986. We reduced rates, but we also eliminated some capital formation incentive programs. Should we reinstitute, for instance, preference taxes on capital gains?
No, I've always believed that the best thing to do is to remove taxes from capital completely, so not to give preferences and loopholes and go back into the game. The 1986 tax reform was a very good piece of legislation in one respect, because it closed up all the disincentives there were to build capital in the wrong places or in less efficient places. We made the mistake of putting too much tax onto capital, so I would say what we need to do is to shift taxes from capital onto consumption. We ought to be taxing consumption, and that would help us to make this important adjustment that we're making in the U.S. economy at this point.
Alan, give us your opinion on the use of zero coupon bonds. They've been used rather effectively to help the Mexicans get off from under some of their debt. How about using zero coupon bonds to help finance the U.S. Treasury obligations and thereby reduce annual interest payments?
Yes, I urged that very strongly when I was a consultant to the Treasury in 1980, when interest rates were very high. We would have saved several $1 billion in interest payments if the Treasury had taken that advice. But now is a good time to do that. Anytime is a good time to do that, to get it established so that, in fact, if we go through another period of high inflation and high interest rates, the Treasury won't be permanently paying 15-16% on some of its bonds, as it did under the 1981-1982 bond issue. So I'm very much in favor of that. It would also be very useful for many people in the economy who would like to have a real rate of interest, for example, a savings and loan association, to hook its mortgages to. And if it had such a bond that it could buy, it could do a lot in issuing mortgages which would be indexed. So that's a very good thing, and it's an important adjustment for us to take.
Alan, you just suggested that monetary policy was in a comfortable position, but some would suggest, based upon the growth rate of reserves and the growth rate of M1, M2, or M3, that over the past year, the Fed has been very tight. Others would suggest, on the other hand, that because of the positive yield curve and the fact that short rates are much lower than long rates, which is a classic sign of monetary ease, that policy has been very easy. Could either of these proponents be correct?
Well, I don't think you want to look at 1987 by itself. There was a very rapid run-up in money aggregates in 1986 during the policy of trying to push down the dollar very rapidly, and then a reversal of that beginning in 1987. So if you average the two together, and if you look at, I think, the best measure of what's happening to money, called the monetary base, that number tells us, I think, that we're doing all right, that the money growth rate is consistent with about a 7% growth rate in nominal GNP, and I think that's the right number.
Alan, I want to take you back to your thought that we are overemphasizing the deficit. You may have forged a bipartisan consensus. All the candidates disagree with you. They all seem to be talking about the deficit as a great problem, and such outside economic thinkers as Lee Iacocca focus on it all the time. Why are they wrong, in your judgment?
What's basically important is to look through the deficit at what we do with resources. How much do we spend for consumption and how much do we spend for investment? What we want to think about is how do we use those resources, and the deficit really hides that from us. We also want to look at the question, at such questions as, what's the government spending its money for, state, local, federal, and what's it getting for that money? And that's and when we look at the deficit and focus on that, we don't really distinguish carefully between whether we tax or spend. That's what's important.
What difference does it make whether we tax or spend? The candidates say it doesn't make any difference.
Oh, it makes all the difference in the world. I mean, the question is whether we're going to use the resources efficiently. We're now under pressure to try to get our economy turned around and get it growing and exporting at a relatively high rate. And efficiency is going to be important in that. It makes a difference whether we're spending that money wastefully or whether we're spending that money on things which will produce goods and services that we can export.
When can we look forward, if ever, to a trade surplus again in this country?
Oh, I think it'll be years. But we don't want to do it quickly. It's too big a wrench for the world economy if we were to turn around. Our exports and our trade position is 10% of the world's exports. If we were to turn that around quickly, it would be a terrible wrench in the economy. So what we want to do is to see it turning as it has in the direction of balance, and it will move in that way, but it'll take 4 or 5 years before we get there at best.
What can we do to make sure that we move in the right direction?
I would say the most important things that we can do would be to take some of the taxes off of capital so that we encourage expansion in our economy and put them onto consumption.
You've suggested taking the taxes off capital. Alan Greenspan, when he was here a year ago, when he was out of government and able to speak more freely, made the same suggestion. I don't hear anyone in Congress suggesting this.
That's right. I think consumption taxes are not terribly popular, but there are growing numbers of people. I think it's a long time before we're going to see that change come about, but there are growing numbers of people talking about it, and I think the way you get policy change is to get some discussion about those issues first.
Thank you for talking with us. As always, lucid and fascinating. Thanks very much, Alan Meltzer. Thanks very much, panelists. Hope you'll be back with us again next week. Then we'll turn from an economy that may have given you a headache to the industry that is designed to cure the headache. We'll be talking about the drug stocks with a guest who's a top expert on them, Ronald Nordman. So if your finances have been ailing lately, take 2 aspirins and make a firm appointment to join us. Meanwhile, this has been Wall Street Week. I'm Louis Rukeyser. Good night.
Wall Street Week with Louis Rukeyser has been brought to you by public television stations. By CSX, the company that puts things in motion. By Prudential Bates Securities, the investment firm with rock-solid resources and market-wise thinking in the business of making money. And by Primerica, the new name in financial services and specialty retailing, a company with the resources to fund growth for tomorrow. Primerica, a name to remember. For a transcript of this program, send $5 to Transcripts, Wall Street Week, Owings Mills, Maryland, 21117. That's $5 to Transcripts, Wall Street Week, Owings Mills, Maryland, 21117.
Stay tuned for the McNeil Lehrer News Hour.
Wall Street Week transcripts are also available to subscribers of the Dow Jones News Retrieval Service. Wall Street Week with Louis Rukeyser is produced by Maryland Public Television, which is solely responsible for its content.